Welcome to Virtual Newsmakers. Today we are very excited about our guest. If you're a Star Wars fan, or you have kids, or you're very interested in how people are using virtual and digital worlds to create stories for humanity, we have a great guest for you. Her name is Chantal Harvey, and she comes to us from the Netherlands, which we're very excited about. And she has partnered up with a very interesting man that you all, most, if you're a Star Wars fan, you're going to recognize who we're talking about soon. So anyway, I'd like to introduce Chantal Harvey. My name is Cynthia Seymour. I'm here with my co-host, Debbie Ellickson, and we're going to get started with Virtual Newsmakers today. So, Chantal, thank you for joining us today.
You're very welcome. I'm very happy to be here. Thank you.
So, can you start off a little bit by telling us a little bit of the history and how you got started with your current project and what your current project is for our audience?
Yes, sure I can. The current project is actually making e-books for children, for very young kids, fun e-books with a little bit of an educational tinge to it. And we use Machinima, or real-time animation, to bring some action into it, you know, to make them exciting.
So this Machinima, are you using a certain platform or a certain way to create these animations? And can you describe for the audience who doesn't know, what is Machinima?
Yeah, of course. Machinima is a technique. It actually comes from a misspelling. It's a combination of the word machine and cinema. It was misspelled by the guy that started the phrase. Actually, that's why it's famous nowadays, I think. Machinima is making use of games or virtual worlds or platforms, and you film the footage that you see on your screen. And it has started a long time ago, like 10 years ago, with people doing game reports, you know, the battles that people have online, the quests they do when they're in game. Somebody found a way to record that. And, of course, the next step was to manipulate the images and make little stories with them. And this is what I've been doing for the last 6 or 7 years.
Can you do me another? So tell us how you evolved into this, because your background in publishing and obviously this is publishing on steroids, is it not?
Yes. I think, you know, with my background actually comes from art and television. I've run my own TV station, local TV station, for over 10 years. And when I got really fed up with TV, I went into animation. I found a virtual world called Second Life and started to fall in love with the images and all the possibilities that you can do there. You can create your own movie sets. There's a large community. You socialize. You meet other people. You team up. Sometimes you work alone. And the content of all the graphics, you know, that you see there got me so hooked on making these little films that you go on for years and years and years. I started my own film festival. I started doing contests, competitions, organizing them, entering them. And then you start to think, what else could I do with it? And if I see the e-books around me for small kids, it sort of seems to be stuck at the little duck that swims around the boat.
Yeah.
Now,
the kids that I know, they've got their own iPad. They've got their own handheld, right? So they're not really interested in the graphics that we see nowadays. And if you want to use full-blown CGI, it's going to be a very costly affair. So if, you know, I just got this idea. I talked to Tony, my business partner, and we said, how about making e-books for kids and using Machinima? And after 3 years of R&D, we sort of, you know, we can do it. And we can do it 50 times faster than CGI.
So that's actually a brilliant idea and a brilliant use of Second Life. And my daughter made me put my avatar outfit on.
It's lovely.
So if you'll just bear with me, but one of the things I loved about Second Life was I studied architecture, and to be able to get into this world and create all kinds of objects and worlds and buildings and gardens and dresses and all of that. Debbie, you can create everything physically in this, or virtually in this virtual world.
So explain to the audience how you get into Second Life, like how you would start a profile and how you get into it, because obviously for a lot of people who are even in the publishing world or authors who might be interested in this format, how do you get into Second Life? Like, how do you discover it in order to tap these creative juices?
Well, all you need to do is go to the website, secondlife.com, and you create your avatar, you choose a name, and you log in, and you discover. And what you said about other publishers, there's quite a lot of people in Holland now discovering the graphics in Second Life, and you go to other people that create all this content, and the courtesy, of course, is, and thinking of copyrights, you ask, can I make photographs at your place? Because people create their own little environment.
Yeah.
You see the most beautiful, beautiful sims, as we call them. A sim is, it looks like a virtual island. It sounds very complicated, but once you're in there, you start exploring, and some people will say, hey, this is not for me. But if you, for publishing, I would say it's probably the best place to be, because you can create your own content, and you own the copyright. Or you ask people for permission, and then you have the right. And just think of if you go outside on the street and you want to make photographs for a children's book or make drawings or cartoons, just think how many months you'd work on that, right? If you want to create everything yourself, or even with help of your friends. But if you find a good graphic place, like a game or a virtual world, I would say it's the publishing of the future.
Yeah. So did you meet Tony on Second Life, or how did you all start working together? And give a little history on Tony so that our audience can reference who we're missing today.
Yeah, Tony's got the flu. He would have been here, but he's totally in cuckoo land at the moment, I'm sorry to say. Get well, Tony, please, quickly.
Yes.
Well, Tony's he's a special effect man. He worked in Hollywood for many, many years. He worked on James Bond movies. He created the most famous robot, most lovable robot in the whole wide world, R2-D2. Oh, he's worked on many movies, done many projects, has also been very active online, always. He's one of these people, that said, I will never retire, no matter what. He loves his work too much. Yeah, he's a good example for all of us, I think. So, Tony came to Second Life. He was asked by a university to do a project. The project didn't catch on. So he was still hanging around, trying to make a virtual studio for his movies. And that's when people pointed me towards him, because I was looking for a head of jury for the very famous 48-hour film project. They actually have, as one of their cities, they have since 6 years now. Yeah, 6 years. They've got Machinima as a city. So people from all over the world can enter it. So you don't need to wait till it comes to your own hometown, but you can enter it virtually with gaming footage. So that's how I met Tony. I asked him to be a judge. He said yes. And after the competition, we just continued working together. And we still are now. So
now you're making these children's books using the virtual worlds as a set and a background to create these animations that tell stories. Is that how that works?
Yes. Yeah. Nice. Well, Tony writes stories, and of course we know what we can do. We push the limit. We've been doing R&D for 3 years, and believe me, it was very, very interesting years, very hard years sometimes. Also, a lot of fun. We laugh a lot, we talk a lot, so that makes up for it. But it's not as easy as it seems, though it's a lot easier than having a studio, a very costly studio in Hollywood or anywhere else in the world. So it's a combination of things. So Tony writes the story, and then he builds the sets too. He builds them. We buy things that other people create. We find solutions. I'm working on the light all the time then, because we have these settings in Second Life where you can change the light to be anything you want it to be. Imagine, you know, when you have your own studio and you can turn the sun to the other side because you want the light to come in from that side. And then you say, I think I want some, you know, sunshine on this side. So you can do all these things. You can change the speed of the clouds or no clouds at all. All these things. You can make it rain. You can make it snow. So it's the perfect platform, actually, for films. And that's where I come in. So it's good teamwork.
Yeah, it is really, really very cool. Debbie, in these worlds, you can make it dark or, you know, I mean, it's really super neat. And you create, you can travel from place to place, and there's people that have created full-fledged reproductions of Kyoto or Tulum in Mexico and ruins and all these things, and they are very, very elaborate virtual worlds and very elaborate animated virtual avatars. And the idea that she's actually taking this platform and translating it into a storytelling for children is, to me, when I saw that, I got the chills. I mean, it's almost hard to explain without experiencing, at least stepping into that world and seeing how that translation gets made.
Well, for me too, and having come from the static publishing background, it's always been I've always been looking for that futuristic book and how you can apply it, anybody can apply it, where you basically take the gaming industry and turn it into a book. So because most of your e-books are static as a print book, and they need to be interactive, particularly when you factor in, like, your daughter, Cynthia. How old is she? Five?
She's five.
She's never known a world without gaming. She's never known anything without the schools. And your son, who's, what, 15? He's never known a world without computers or gaming.
He's in the middle. He, believe it or not, even though he's 16, he's really in this limbo land. She is born, basically, with an iPad in her hand.
Yeah.
And knows how to use it just like breathing. I mean, they don't. There's no learning gap or anything at all. So they jump into these worlds really easily. And
so when we look at the books, and when we look at the books that we give them when they're kids at today as a 10-year-old or 5-year-old, they want to keep this going when they become adults. And that's why when, you know, I always challenge people, if you want to write a book for young adults or kids, pay attention to what they're looking at and how they're receiving their information. And if you go into a coffee shop and you see a 20-something, if you get a glance at their laptop or their device, check to see what they're looking at. 99.9% of the time, it's a video. So... So we need to create our books to
making choices along the way, too. They like being part of the storytelling process. I can say that from her. So there's this heightened imagination. Instead of being given the story, they like to be part of that storytelling process. Is there a way to do that with what you all are doing, Chantal?
Yes, that's our next aim. We're still looking for the right software. We did an Indiegogo earlier this year to get the funding to get more and better secure software, because the software we have now does it. But once we put it on Amazon, it's out there and anybody could take it. So we're really trying to secure it, the 3 years' work we have for the first book. So we're still looking for it, but The book we're making now, The Medieval Farm with the Bobbikins, is 25 snippets of film. Of course, it's one film of about, I'd say, 18 minutes, 19 minutes. It's divided in 25 parts, and if you watch the book on your iPad, you just turn the pages over, and you can go back. And underneath it gives a text, and we've got a narrator. We've got a lovely, lovely English lady that does the narration for us.
Nice.
We have an English musician that lives in Denmark, and she did the music for us. We've got a Dutch girl that lives in England that did the graphics for us. It's like, it's girl power, the project.
Well, let me ask you this. How do you all work together? How do you make your team work together when you're located in all these different places? Because I think this is one of the most compelling things about us being able to do this today, is that we're all in different worlds.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about that virtual teamwork that you experience?
Yes. We do have Skype calls, but well, Skype is a very handy place to be. But we also meet in Second Life, and we all wear our Bobbikin avatars, and we hop around the sim. We've got a sim called Toy City that Tony designed. And all the team members have a Bobbikin avatar, and we just go kaboom, 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 kaboom. We go all over the room, we have fun. And then in the middle, there's a big playground where we all sit down on our virtual toys, and we talk together. And it's like a Google Hangout, but not with real people, but with avatars.
Animation.
Yeah, it is.
So when you do this, you actually have these meetings, but then do you turn around and act out the parts and the storyline as well?
Yes.
So you're not just meeting as teammates, you're also acting it out.
Yes. Yes, we are.
Cool.
Yeah. Yeah.
That is very cool.
It is collaboration, yes. Yeah, we're very lucky to have a talented team.
Did you get a certain artist within Second Life to design out the avatar, or did Tony do that too?
We had an artist that designed the avatars, but we've tweaked them to our own liking.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Debbie, I don't want you to get hooked on this because I won't see you again.
That's where I'm jumping on this weekend.
Oh, yeah. Well, if you go in there, befriend me, and I'll show you around.
What is your avatar's name, Chantal?
Oh, guess what? It's Chantal Harvey.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, my Dutch name is very difficult to pronounce, my surname. So I've taken the Harvey. Chantal is my first name. But in Holland, my real surname is Gerards. Which is very difficult. So I stuck with Harvey. Everybody knows me as Harvey. So even my daughter calls me Harvey Breakfast. You know. So yeah. I'm known.
I am not Synergy Daily. Mine is Synergy Daily. I haven't been on in a really long time, but it's Synergy Daily.
Well, I go into work nowadays, but I have to say the first year, I was pretty hooked. And after that, you calm down, and then you start to see, well, I've always been hooked on the art, because there's so many artists there, and they do the most beautiful things. If you talk about virtual art, well, it's like heaven, isn't it? So
it really is. It's absolutely terrific, Debbie, because these artists go in and they use this platform to create things in what are called sandboxes. So their avatars are actually creating these sculptures, and some of them will teach you. They'll have full-fledged instructional lessons with teachers teaching you how to make things, starting from very beginner level all the way to super advanced animated, you know, the sculptures. I mean, there's art and sculpture in there.
Well, what I find is interesting, you said that whatever you create in there is your own copyright. Did I hear you say that correct?
Well, it used to be like that, and at the moment there's a big upset in Second Life. Lindelab is changing the terms. They say they are co-owners. So actually for writers, for the things we use it for our books, that could be bad news. Everything we've created so far is our own, but at the moment we're really looking into it, if we can carry on like this. Yeah. But if not, there's enough other worlds. It's like there's OpenSim, different projects for schools. You can now even have a virtual world on your USB stick and carry it with you. Sim on a stick, it's called. So when one world goes down, the other world comes up. So.
Okay, so you can transfer that stuff that you built in that platform to other virtual worlds.
You can transfer, yeah, well, I'd rather not, because I'm quite, you know, the sim we have now, the design we have, took a long time to make, but if needed, yes, of course. Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, that's quite a time investment, actually, to walk away from. Can you work at anything? Is Philip Rosedale still running it, or who's?
No, Philip Rosedale left. He left a couple of years ago and then came back as interim. He was on the board, and he's actually creating his new virtual world now.
Ah,
he's creating a virtual world that is based in real life.
Uh-huh.
So it's like gamification all around you.
Mm. Wow.
So you can see your own avatar or your virtual shoulder pads, and, you know, anybody with the same mobile or glasses can see that too. So he's
brilliant.
Once again, he's taking it one step further, which other people are too, because I'm involved in a project in Finland at the moment where we just came back from. And they are outer space labs, and they are actually implementing avatars in real life and games.
Nice.
I don't know where we will be in 1 or 2 years from now, but it's nothing like we are now.
Right.
It's really going fast now. It's exciting.
It is exciting, and these are like really groundbreaking things. It's fun to see them evolve forward the way that they have.
Yes.
Out of this conversation, if you could give tips to publishers and business owners about how they might work together virtually, do you have anything there that might be able to help our viewers kind of get their feet wet in working virtually, even though they're in different places?
Well, my favorite way would be in games or virtual worlds. But of course, this is my first Google Hangout. Thank you, girls.
Good.
I'm quite enjoying it. So
nice.
It's anything online, Skype, the Hangouts, but yeah, why not in a game? Why not in World of Warcraft or Sims Online?
Yeah, that's,
I mean,
really.
It's yeah.
And that's I think what people don't realize is that these games are really people's personalities and coming together and working together.
Yes. Your avatar actually gives a lot away about you, I think. Yeah. The avatars that people choose, you know, you can get the most extreme fantasy creatures or dragons, or that's how I met Tony. He was a dragon. The humanoids, the little tiny animals and thingies, or the paper. There's somebody that walks around like a paper bag or a chair, you know, a lamp. There's an avatar called Lamp. And it's so interesting because you see these people and I'm always tempted to ask, why did you make that one? Why do you look like that? It's fun. It tells a lot about you, actually. And people identify with their avatar. That's why I think the avatar is there to stay, yeah.
Yeah. It's interesting, too, because they were really the first ones and the only ones that I know of that started creating ways for people to be able to communicate in different languages, Debbie. So somebody could be typing in Japanese and it would come out English on the other side. Oh, or I could be typing English and communicating with somebody in Japan. Now, whether or not the translation was an exact perfect translation, what is always a questionable thing, but at least we were able to communicate globally in a way that didn't require English as the primary language. So there's a tremendous amount of vision that happened in that project, I can tell you that, on that platform.
And for virtual collaborations, that's huge.
Yeah, it is huge. Now, from our standpoint, Chantal, you could actually meet with real people virtually all over the world and work together commonly on documents using Google Docs in real time. which is what Debbie and I do. She's in Canada and I'm in Miami, and we pull all of this together virtually like you do. And it's brilliant for us to be able to interview from the comfort of our couch and living room.
Yeah.
People like you in Netherlands from all over the world. So.
And isn't it wonderful how the world became a bigger place because of this?
It's amazing.
All the people you meet, I mean, all the people I met that I first met online. It's amazing. It's like one good example is I met this German guy from Berlin, and he built his own sim, and he has the Berlin community, and we met a couple of, we were always talking, and a couple of years later we met in Amsterdam for a festival, and we couldn't stop talking. But you know what, he's a 28 years old lad, and one time I said to him after 3 hours non-stop tap, I said, Jan, would we have ever talked to each other if we not had met online first? He said, never. There's 30 years of age difference between us, and you know, and it doesn't matter anymore. Once you meet online and you communicate, I met a lot of people that way, and it's fun. It's fun.
Yeah. It is really fun.
Girls ever meet?
We have not physically met. We have
been doing this for what, 2 years now?
We are best of friends. We tell each other everything. We work together. We fight together. We cry together. We pull our hair out together. We reach out to people. We meet people. Our whole world has been altered. For me, the shift from the avatar, I got G+ right away, especially Hangouts, because I was already indoctrinated by the avatar, being an avatar on Second Life. That it was an easy shift for me to jump into that. This is probably Greek to most people. I did create an avatar for my son when he was about 11, and kind of monitored his activities together, you know, but I wanted him to see that world. And, you know, to me, you know, it's about that global connectivity that enables people like you and Tony Dyson to meet each other and make these things happen, you know, not ever even, you know. So you visited him recently?
Yes, I did.
Nice.
Yeah. And we went to Finland together for Robotics Week.
Very fun.
Yeah, very fun. And you know, it's like you carry on, you switch your computer off, you catch the airplane, and then as soon as you start, you know, you meet and you go up, you go on where you left. So, yeah, it's
great.
Let me
ask you this. When you first met him, what was that moment like?
Yeah.
I recognized him, of course, but that's the same with everybody you meet.
Yeah.
It's people you talk to online, and then you meet them in life. Yeah.
It's like the barriers are gone.
Yes,
that
exactly.
Initial the familiarity is already there.
It's so nice when the mind meets first, and then the rest follows.
Yeah, that's nice.
Yeah.
I love that.
Yeah.
So for people who have never experienced anything like this and might have a phobia of this or whatever, what would you challenge people to do to get their feet wet with being virtual, like global and virtual, and being a part of this larger potential, you know, movement, change that's happening?
Well, I always say to people, go with the flow and always try new things. You can still abandon them, you know, just try it. My dad is 86 and he got a new laptop. You know, it's no problem. I install Skype for him and tell him how email works. He writes it down and he gets on with it. I would not dream of suggesting to him to go into Second Life or make an avatar. But I think if you're creative or curious, nosy, why not explore life? And with every new technology, there's always people screaming murder I call it. Like, television would do this to us, and, you know, even cinema, it would do that to us.
Right.
Everybody was reading a newspaper. I saw a cartoon earlier this week on Facebook where you see a photograph of a train cabin, and you see 30 guys all reading their newspaper. Now, what is that? In 2013, everybody sits with their mobile, but nothing has changed. So you might as well go with the flow and try new things. And if it's not for you, then at least you tried.
I love that. Oh, I love that idea. So how can people, if there are parents watching or people who want to see your books, how do we direct them to find you?
Okay. If they go to the website thesaurus.com, it will lead you to our publishing website, which is NetDreamerPublications.com.
Okay.
And, well, the first book is not out yet. We're almost there. As I said, we did the Indiegogo. We didn't reach the funds we wanted to do, so we couldn't outsource. So we're doing all the work ourselves.
Oh, boy.
And we said we'd publish in August, but we haven't quite made it. So I'm counting on spring and hopefully sooner. And it's a pity we didn't get it ready for Christmas.
Yeah.
The first book is called Medieval Farm.
Uh-huh.
And yeah, I hope it's out soon.
Okay, well, let me ask you this. Would you like to come back and show us Medieval Farm once it's ready to get out there?
Yes, of course.
Okay.
Yes,
we would love
That's a deal. Yeah.
We would love to help the world know about Medieval Farm, and we look forward to helping get the word out about this.
Thank you. Yes, it'll be fun. Yeah.
Good. Did you said at the end of our show, we kind of glossed over and didn't really get into sharing a screen share, and you had mentioned you might like to show an animated screen share. Mm-hmm. And while we were hesitant to do it in the middle of the show, I think if we all fall off at the end of the show, it's not so much of a difficult thing to pull back up. Would you like to try to screen share a little video of what you're talking about?
Okay, let's see if I can do that. It's the video that is used in the book, so it's we've got it online on Vimeo with a password, but I'm willing to give a little preview. If I can find the right button, Q&A.
I think it is that little green one that has screen share, and it may or may not work, but we might as well try.
Okay, I'm going to hit the button and start a film. Let's see. Okay.
And if we blow up, people, we'll be back. Or we'll see you next week.
Okay. Is it showing at all?
No.
Not yet.
No.
The phone's not streaming, so... I think,
It
probably, if your bandwidth is limited, and Google, this Hangout will probably take most of it, so that could be the issue too.
I see, and I'm on Wi-Fi, so I'm on the laptop.
That's shaky right there.
Okay, you guys will have to wait till the book is out.
I tell you what, we'll do that, and we'll get this figured out between now and then, so we can share a little bit of that, and if you have little videos you'd like to share with us, we're more than happy to share that with what we've got going on too.
Okay. And if people go to Tony's website or my website or even through NetDreamer Publications, it will show videos. We've got some examples. We did a competition for the Doritos during the big game in America. You know, they have a big contest every year for that. We did a 30-second Machinima, but alas, we didn't win.
It's not just a big game. It's called Super Bowl.
That's the one. Well, excuse me, we don't have it in Holland. Super Bowl. We tried to get in there.
Debbie knows more about the Super Bowl than I do, and I'm the only American in the room. So.
Okay.
Well, it's been a pleasure, Chantal. We love having you here, and we look forward to interviewing you again in the springtime when the
Thank you. I look forward to coming back.
Good. And we're going to close out today, and we will see you all next week on Virtual Newsmakers. See y'all later.
Bye-bye.